So in this lecture, we look at what is called the de Moivre formula. So excuse my French. So this is a formula which, which is very elegant and which actually follows from Euler's result that we have seen in the earlier lecture. And it has some very interesting consequences. So we look at an example of how this can be used. Okay, so we have seen the Euler formula, which says that the real part of e to the I theta is just cos theta, and the imaginary part of e to the I theta is sine theta. So e to the I theta is cos theta plus I sine theta. So if you take the nth power on both sides, so we get cos theta plus I sine theta the whole power n, which is taking the nth power on the right hand side is much easier because it's just an exponential. It's just e to the I n theta. So we see that taking the nth power of a complex number tends to cause its, particularly for a complex number of this kind, which has no modulus. So the modulus is just, not no modulus, but it has whose modulus is unity. And so when you take the nth power of, the modulus remains unchanged, and it's only the phase which keeps increasing value in value, and then it starts, it rotates around the circle, in fact. So what you have is e to the I n theta, so which is equal to cos n theta plus I times sine of n theta, right? Where which we have once again applied the the same Euler formula. So in fact, this leads us to the de Moivre formula, which is the statement that cos n theta plus I sine n theta, which is equal to cos theta plus I times sine theta the whole power n. So this result allows us to extract some useful trigonometric identities. So we look at an example here. Okay, so if I put n is equal to 2 here, so I get cos 2 theta plus I times sine 2 theta is equal to cos theta plus I sine theta the whole square, right? So if I expand, then I have cos squared theta, and then I squared sine squared theta is the same as minus sine squared theta, then plus I times cos theta sine theta plus I times sine theta cos theta, which is the same as I times 2 cos theta sine theta. And then we can compare, when two complex numbers are equal, it means necessarily that the real part of each complex number is the same, and also the imaginary parts separately of these two complex numbers must be the same. So the real part here on the left hand side is cos 2 theta, and the real part on the right hand side is cos squared theta minus sine squared theta. So we have cos 2 theta is equal to cos squared theta minus sine squared theta, and likewise the imaginary part on the left hand side is sine of 2 theta, the imaginary part on the right hand side is 2 cos theta sine theta. So we have the result sine 2 theta is equal to 2 sine theta cos theta, right? So both of these are familiar trigonometric identities. And so we have just managed to, obtain these results using de Moivre's formula. So if we had taken the third power instead of the second power, right, so we would have got this result, cos theta plus I sine 3 theta is equal to cos theta plus I sine theta, the whole to the power 3. So carefully collecting terms, we have cos cube theta, then we have plus, 3 I sine theta the whole squared cos theta. So that will give us a minus 3 sine squared theta cos theta. Plus, if you take the square with the cosine term, and then I is just I. So then you have 3 cos squared theta sine theta with I. And then when you take I sine theta the whole cube, so I squared will give you a minus 1, and then you have 1 I extra. So you get minus I sine cube theta. Right. So now once again, we can collect the real part and the imaginary part separately, and then compare the left hand side and right hand side, which leads us to yet another useful trigonometric identity. So which is this cos 3 theta is the same as cos cube theta minus 3 cos theta sine squared theta, and likewise sine 3 theta is equal to 3 cos squared theta sine theta minus sine cube theta. So there is nothing to prevent us from going to higher powers. So if we have seen that, you know, 2, of course, when we take n equal to 2, it gives us a result which we are all completely familiar with. And when we take n equal to the third power, we get a result which perhaps we have seen, but maybe some of us have not seen. But it's, you know, it's a way of writing cosine of, you know, some number times theta in terms of this cosines and sines of theta, right? So that's why it has some use. In fact, you can go ahead and generalize it to the nth power using the binomial theorem. So cos of n theta plus I times sine of n theta is equal to cos theta plus I sine theta the whole power n. And so this is the nth power of a sum of two terms, and when we expand using the binomial theorem, so, and then we collect terms also carefully. So when I do cosine n of theta is the first term, then I if I take cosine square cosine of n to the minus 2 theta, then it's going to have a n over n choose 2, but there's also going to be I squared, right? I squared will give me a minus sign, and there's a sine squared of theta. And then likewise, I have first term, second, this is the third term, then the fourth term, if I will collect it separately, fifth term again is, you're going to get I to the power 4, which will be just 1. So all of these contribute to the real part. And likewise, the imaginary part is going to be, the even terms in this case. Actually, this is the first term, then the second term, the fourth term, and so on, will all come with I's, right? You have to be careful with the signs. So because I Q is going to be minus I, right? So this is something that we, if we carefully collect terms, we have I times n choose 1 cos to the n minus 1 theta times sine theta minus n choose 3 cos to the n minus 3 of theta times sine cube of theta, and so on, right? So now, some thought reveals that, of course, each of these, series are not going to keep on going forever, right? We have seen examples, so they're going to end. So in fact, you're going to have cosines and sines in each of these, the sum of which will always be n. So if you have the n, if you have the kth power of sine theta, then you're going to get n minus kth power of cosine of theta in each of these. And, you have to be careful about exactly how these powers are apportioned between cosines and sines. And so you see that some of these terms are part of the imaginary part, and the other terms are in the real part, right? So, and this also depends on whether n is even or odd. You will see how to, at what point it's going to terminate each of these series. So we can, carefully collect all these terms. If some little bit of thought you can show, you can convince yourself of this following result. If n equal to m, we get these identities. Cosine of 2m theta, I'm directly writing in place of n 2m. Cosine of 2m theta is equal to summation over k. And so this is something that you can check. K will go from 0 to m. 2m choose 2k. So we see that only even powers appear. So we see that n is equal to 2m. So of course, n itself will appear, and then n minus 2, n minus 4, even powers in cos theta appear, and then even powers in sine theta also appear, right? Cosine of 2m of theta. And likewise, when we do sine of 2m of theta, this is going to contain odd powers in cos theta and odd powers in sine theta as well, so that the sum also always necessarily has to add up to this n, which in this case is 2m. So we have 2m choose 2k plus 1 minus 1 to the k cosine of 2m minus 2k minus 1 of theta sine to the power 2k plus 1 of theta. So the this sine also has odd powers and cosine also has odd powers. The sum of these two necessarily always is n, which is 2m in this case. Right, and so if n is an odd number, on the other hand, we have the following identity. So now you get cosine of 2m plus 1 theta is summation over k going from 0 to m. So again, you get powers of the sine powers are all even here, and the cosine powers are all odd in this case, right? So you have to, these two have to add up to 2n+1. So one of them has to be odd, the other one has to be even. And on the other hand, the sine expansion is going to contain terms in which the cosine powers are all even and the sine powers are all odd, right? So this is a set of identities which all follow from the joint use of the De Moivre formula along with the binomial theorem, right? So it is for you to check that we've got all these coefficients correctly. And so there are also some other interesting series which one can derive with the use of the De Moivre formula, right? So you can look up some textbooks, maybe there'll be some homework along these lines. But so the whole point of this lecture is to illustrate that complex numbers give you some extra power, right? And particularly when used in conjunction with other tools like the binomial theorem, you can derive these beautiful trigonometric identities. That's all for this lecture. Thank you.